You might remember the big wave scene from Interstellar, showing how powerful and huge natural events can be. The tsunamis in the movie were taller than any mountain on Earth. Even though that's just in movies, we do have real tsunamis on our planet, and they can cause a lot of damage to entire communities. These events are connected to how the Earth's plates move, especially in areas called subduction zones. One of these, called the Cascadia Subduction Zone, going from southern Canada to northern California, could be very dangerous for the Pacific Northwest. So what does this mean for the people living nearby? And what are they doing to get ready for something like this? Watch the video to get the answers you are looking for. Cascadia Subduction Zone. The Cascadia Subduction Zone is a geological hotspot off the west coast with the potential for powerful seaquakes. First, what's a subduction zone? Imagine two massive plates colliding beneath the ocean. One plate is forced below the other in a process called subduction. Cascadia is one of them. It's where the Juan de Fuca plate is diving beneath the North American plate. This zone stretches from Northern California to Southern British Columbia. This distance amounts to approximately 800 miles, comparable to the length of about 13,333 football fields lined up end to end. So why does it matter? Subduction zones are hotspots for seismic activity, causing seaquakes or underwater earthquakes. These events can trigger tsunamis as the seafloor shifts. Around the world, there are several subduction zones, and one of the most infamous is the Ring of Fire, encircling the Pacific Ocean. This region is known for its high seismic activity level. What sets the Cascadia Subduction Zone apart is its potential for an enormous earthquake, capable of causing widespread devastation. Scientists warn that stress is building up along the Cascadia Subduction Zone, and when released, it could result in a megathrust earthquake. The last such event occurred in 1700, and scientists believe these quakes have a recurrence interval of several centuries. We might be on the verge of one of the deadliest natural disasters ever. Scientists say if a big earthquake hits, there could be serious consequences. The ground shaking would damage buildings and put people in danger. Huge tsunamis might flood coastal areas because of the earthquake under the sea. The land might change and there could be aftershocks, which are more shaking than after the main earthquake. This could cause big problems for important things like roads and bridges. Fixing everything would cost a lot of money, and it might take a lot of time. Nature could be affected too, with landslides and changes to where animals live. For people, it might be really tough having to leave their homes and figuring out how to stay safe. To get ready, scientists and communities are working together. They're making buildings stronger, setting up warning systems, and planning how to help people if it happens. Everyone is trying to be ready so that if a big earthquake comes, they can keep people safe and get things back to normal as quickly as possible. Take ground shaking, for instance. It's a result of the intense release of energy caused by the sudden movement of tectonic plates. The Juan de Fuca plate, subducting beneath the North American plate, gets locked due to friction. When the stress overcomes this friction, it leads to a rapid release of accumulated energy, resulting in seismic waves that propagate throughout the Earth. This seismic energy causes the ground to shake, and the intensity of shaking can vary across different regions. Areas closer to the epicenter experience stronger shaking, while those farther away may still feel significant tremors. The duration of shaking depends on factors such as the size of the earthquake and the distance from the source. To brace for such seismic risks, communities are taking steps to reduce the impact of ground shaking. They're making sure buildings are strong enough to handle earthquakes by following strict rules. Early warning systems give people a heads up, letting them take cover and stay safe when the shaking starts. People are also learning about what to do during an earthquake. By spreading the word on safety and encouraging everyone to be ready for emergencies, communities are helping individuals feel more prepared. Bridges are designed to be strong, following specific earthquake standards, and services also take into account a possible disaster. Some people are planning ahead too. They're figuring out which areas are most at risk, planning the best way for people to get to safety, and making sure emergency services are ready to help quickly. Comparison with the San Andreas Fault. When considering the potential danger of a Cascadia earthquake, it's essential to draw comparisons with historical events, like the 1994 earthquake along the San Andreas Fault in Southern California. In 1994, a magnitude 6.7 earthquake struck the Northridge area, causing significant damage. It resulted in the loss of 57 lives and left over 8,700 people injured. The impact was substantial, with collapsed buildings, damaged infrastructure, and widespread disruption to daily life. Now, looking at the Cascadia Subduction Zone, the potential for a much larger earthquake exists. Scientists anticipate that Cascadia could experience a megathrust earthquake with a magnitude exceeding 9.0. This magnitude is significantly higher than the 1994 San Andreas event, indicating a release of energy several times more powerful. The danger lies not just in the earthquake itself, but in the accompanying tsunamis that could affect coastal regions. The 1994 San Andreas earthquake, while severe, did not generate tsunamis on the scale that a Cascadia event could. The combination of intense ground shaking, potential tsunamis, and the wide geographical reach of the Cascadia Subduction Zone magnifies the potential impact, making it a more formidable and challenging scenario for preparedness and response. While infrequent, earthquakes as formidable and devastating as those anticipated from the Cascadia Subduction Zone have occurred in history. For instance, the most recent megathrust earthquake in the Northwest happened in January of 1700, slightly over 300 years ago. Geological evidence suggests that such significant earthquakes have repeated at least 7 times in the last 3,500 years, indicating a recurring interval of 400 to 600 years. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve it for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. We only found out 50 years ago. Surprisingly, we only found out about the Cascadia Subduction Zone around 50 years ago. Before that, no one knew about this fault line that could cause big problems on the West Coast. So how did scientists figure it out? The Cascadia Fault is tricky because it doesn't cause smaller earthquakes like we usually feel. Unlike other places where earthquakes happen often, Cascadia stayed quiet. In the 1970s, scientists noticed it because it's right along the Ring of Fire, a group of volcanoes and faults around the Pacific Ocean plate. Then, they wondered if Cascadia ever caused any trouble. In the 1980s, scientists discovered a ghost forest in Washington. This forest was wiped out all at once by a rush of seawater dated between August 1699 and May of 1700. Japan's records told another part of the story. They had a mysterious tsunami on January 27, 1700, which matched the date of Cascadia's big earthquake. Around 9 o'clock on the night of January 26, 1700, a massive earthquake happened, causing the land to sink, drowning forests and making a huge wave. Half of the wave reached the northwest coast in about 15 minutes, and the other half took 10 hours to reach Japan. Now, knowing that this has happened before makes us worry about the future. The chances of another big earthquake by 2050 are about 1 in 3. So, scientists keep studying and getting ready to protect people from any future trouble with Cascadia. Tips for survival. In modern Cascadia, where people have little experience with tsunamis, seeking guidance for survival becomes crucial. While many believe that the big one, a magnitude 9 earthquake, might be the main threat, the account from Mall in Chile teaches a different lesson. The people there survived the biggest earthquake ever measured in 1960, but the real danger came later with the tsunami that followed. History teaches valuable lessons. First, surviving the earthquake is likely for many, but the real trouble begins with the first tsunami waves. Even if an earthquake doesn't guarantee a tsunami, leading to higher ground away from the coast and waiting for things to settle might be the safest course of action. The priority is saving lives, not possessions. In the unfortunate event that the earthquake triggers a tsunami, expecting multiple waves, with the next one potentially larger, is crucial information. Tsunamis can last for hours, posing an extended threat. Scientists have contributed significantly to our understanding of tsunamis. In a notable incident in 1960, seismologist Jerry Eaton and his team raced against the time to measure the Chilean tsunami in Hilo, Hawaii. Previous deadly tsunamis had struck the area, making measurements essential for identifying at-risk locations. They observed the waves at the Wailuku River Bridge, noting the fluctuating water levels as multiple tsunami waves hit. Here's the full story of the measurements. On May 22, 1960, around 10 p.m., Seismologist Jerry Eaton and four friends gathered at the U.S. Geological Survey's Hawaiian Volcano Observatory on the island of Hawaii. They packed cameras, notebooks, flashlights, and measuring tapes into a Ford station wagon for a 30-mile ride to Hilo, hoping to measure the 1960 Chilean tsunami expected around midnight. The reason behind this effort was Hawaii's history of deadly tsunamis from Chile in 1837 and 1877, as well as one from the Aleutian Islands in 1946 that killed 98 people in Hilo. Eaton and his team checked with the people in Hilo, then set up on the Wailuku River Bridge on Hilo Bay. They knew the previous bridge was destroyed in the 1946 Aleutian tsunami. The new bridge became their observation post to measure the water level, just in case they planned a quick sprint to higher ground. Shortly after midnight, the water under the bridge rose 4 feet above normal, indicating the first wave of the tsunami. The second wave at 12:46 a.m. washed under the bridge at a level 9 feet above normal. By 1 a.m., the water dropped to 7 feet below normal. Eaton heard an ominous noise, a distant rumble from Hilo Bay. 2 minutes later, they saw a wall of water moving towards the city. The wave reached a height of 20 feet, hitting the bridge at a nearly vertical angle. After it passed, Eaton and his team returned to the bridge to record water levels during several more tsunami waves. Their first-hand experience helped enhance our knowledge of tsunami behavior and the importance of timely evacuation to higher ground for safety. Always keep in mind that preparedness can make all the difference during challenging times. Whether it's knowing evacuation routes or having an emergency kit, taking these simple safety measures can be a true lifesaver. That's all for this video. What would you like us to cover next? Feel free to share your thoughts in the comments below and stay tuned for our next videos. We'll see you soon on the channel.